Hello and welcome to my presentation about our work on ARA, static initialization of dynamically created system objects. My name is Björn Fiedler and I'm proud to present our current work. Imagine you've got an embedded real-time system which contains its implementation of the real-time application written down as C code. For this presentation, I will use this minimal example application consisting of two tasks and a single queue to pass messages from one task to the other. During the startup phase, this application initializes hardware components like the serial interface, initializes the operating system with its objects like tasks and queues, and reaches the system setup point. For this example application, the system setup point is the point in time where the control is handed over to the scheduler and the system leaves the startup phase towards the normal operation mode. The system setup point is the first deadline to reach. Before the system setup point is reached, no guarantees about any other deadlines could be given. Furthermore, if rebooting is one of the used failure recovery mechanisms, the way towards the system setup point is part of the critical path of any deadline to reach. Our work focuses on the reduction of the boot time towards the system setup point for embedded real-time systems. If we execute this example application on our embedded system, this ARM board for example, it takes about 40,000 cycles until the application reaches the system setup point. This initialization instructions might feel superfluous and it might look like insanity to do the same thing over and over again on every single boot expecting different results. What would be if we just strike out the initialization of the operating system objects, assuming that this initialization takes place during the compilation of this real-time application? If we then execute this modified version, it takes only about 15,000 cycles to reach the system setup point. So this gap of about 25,000 cycles is our exploration space for our improvements presented in this talk. To reach this goal, we implemented ARA as a whole system optimizer. It performs static compile time analysis and specialization of the operating system towards the application's needs. To give an overview, the ARA system optimizer consists of two major building blocks, the analysis and the synthesis phase. The analysis phase takes the application source code as LVM intermediate representation as input. Additionally, ARA takes the configuration of the used operating system and a model describing the semantics of the operating system call and its system calls as input. ARA uses these inputs to analyze the application and generate the instance list which describes the found operating system objects and their properties. This instance list is then used during the synthesize phase to statically generate system objects and provide specialized system call implementations. The output of the ARA system optimizer, consisting of the modified application as LVM intermediate code and the newly generated operating system objects and functions as C code, is fed back into the usual compiler toolchain to apply link time optimization and produce the system image. Let's start and have a look into the analysis. But before we dig into this analysis, we have to define the desired results we expect the analysis to deliver. The instance list, which is the central part of ARA and the central point for storing information about our system objects, is what we want to construct during the analysis phase. If we take a look inside the application source code, for us as humans, it's quite obvious that this application uses two threads and a single queue. Furthermore, we see that all parameters except the priority of task T2 are known at compile time. But how do we derive this information programmatically from the source code? First, we start with the local control flow graphs for each function. In these graphs, we mark all the system calls, creating system objects as relevant. Now we extend these local control flow graphs to interprocedural control flow graphs. Therefore, we add edges from every call site towards its call target. This is done for direct calls as well as for indirect calls via pointer analysis. Thereby, we mark all calls leading towards system object creation system calls as relevant. The newly constructed interprocedural control flow graphs, short ICFGs, represent all the code reachable from the entry point of the application. As the next step, we start traversing these ICFGs starting from the application's entry point. We call the now following analysis the static instance analysis. The goal of this analysis is to find all the operating system objects and populate our instance list. We start the analysis at the entry point of our application, which is the main function. Therefore, we push this main function on our call stack as we are performing a call path aware analysis and take a look at the first instruction inside this main function. This first instruction is the initialization of the serial interface. This instruction is not marked as relevant, hence we could ignore it and continue the next instruction of this function. The next instruction is the call to the initOS function, which is marked as relevant, hence we have to push it on our call stack and step into this function. Inside the initOS function, the first instruction is the call to xtaskCreate, which is a system object creating system call. Hence, we want to acquire all its parameters. Therefore, we use the static value flow analysis, short SVF, which works on the LVM code and delivers a call path aware value flow graph, which we use to query the arguments of this call. For this example, we see that those parameters are all three constants: the name T1, the function F1, and the value 4 as the task's priority. We denote this information in our instance list, and additionally, we store the information that this object is created exactly once, as this is the only control flow leading towards this system call, and it's surely taken. Additionally, we schedule the function F1 as a new entry point for the static instance analysis, as a task introduces a new control flow which has to be analyzed. The next instruction is the creation of task 2. For this task, the SVF cannot deliver all parameters as the priority is computed during runtime of this application. However, we know about the existence of this task and most of its parameters, and hence we could insert it into our instance list and push its function onto our list of entry points. The analysis of the next instruction, the xqcreate, delivers all the parameters for this queue again. The semantics of the operating system, which is FreeRTOS in this case, denote that the operating system is responsible to provide the memory to store the queue elements. This is the case for the task stacks and control blocks as well. We now have finished the analysis of this function and hence pop it from our call stack and continue the main function. The printf function is the next instruction to be called, but this is not marked as relevant and therefore not further analyzed. The last instruction of the main function is the call to start the scheduler. This instruction changes the state of the operating system model, as all tasks created after the scheduler starts have to be treated differently as they do not belong to the initial set of runnable tasks. Thereby, we reach the end of the control flow of the main function. The analysis of this entry point is now complete and we can continue with the open entry point list. The function F1, which is the next on our entry point list, does not contain any system object creation relevant call sites. Hence, we could skip over and end this analysis for this function. The same is the case for F2. So our analysis is now complete. We have found all information for our instance list. Now that we have finished our analysis, we step over to generate the new operating system objects and functions. But before we can do so, we have to transform our found knowledge into an instance list, which is usable for the specialization. How do we perform this transformation from the gathered information into the instance list, as denoted in the middle of this figure? We use the information about those system objects to classify them regarding their maximal possible specialization. For the task T1 and the queue, a full specialization is possible as we know all their parameters. This means we are able to statically provide the needed memory and fill it with all information it would be filled during runtime. For task T2, as not all parameters are known, we cannot enqueue it into the scheduler's ready list, for example, as we don't know its priority. Hence, only a partial specialization is possible. Based on this classification, we step over into the synthesis phase. At first, we use the instance list to generate the operating system objects statically. For task T1, for example, we generate the stack with the according size and with its entry function as initial parameter. Additionally, we generate the task control block used by the operating system to store information about the runtime state of this task. So for example, the current stack pointer and its position inside the ready list. Furthermore, we generate the scheduler's ready list, one for each priority with the schedulable task already enqueued into. The next step is to exchange the call sites of the application's code. For readability reasons, we denote it as C code changes in this presentation, but all these transformations are executed on the LVM intermediate code. For task T1 and the queue, we eliminate the whole creation system calls as all its effects are already prepared in the generated system objects. For task T2, we exchange the creation call with an activation call, which just enqueues the task at the correct position on the ready list. The start of the scheduler shrinks down to a simple dispatch towards the first task to run, as all other actions are already pre-computed. Now we are able to apply our specialization and try out what effects it has. First, we apply ARA on our initial example and limit its specialization to only perform partial specialization, even if full specialization would be feasible. This means ARA allocates memory for those objects but does not initialize their values. Thereby, we achieve a reduction of about 12,000 cycles of boot time during reaching the system setup point. But if we now enable the full specialization wherever possible, we see that the system setup point is reached after 32,000 cycles, which is worse than the version where we limited ARA to perform only partial specialization. This worsening is caused by data structures moving from the BSS segment towards the data segment, indicated by the color change from green to purple in the lower part of the bars. For each word in the data segment, we have to perform a read and a write instruction during the initialization, while we perform only writes for the BSS segment's words. Therefore, the question arises, do we really need all those read instructions? To answer this question, we have to take a look inside those data structures. Transforming the system calls into data structures with constructors with known values allows the optimization passes to perform constant folding, inlining, and static code evaluation. Thereby, LVM transforms those constructor functions into initializer lists, as all values are computable during compile time. For our newly generated data structures, especially stacks, this is not beneficial, as they contain only a small single initial call frame and are otherwise zeroed all over. But not only our data structures suffer, there are objects in the application's code which suffer too. For example, there are buffers protected by mutex, which gets assigned during construction of those buffers. As we are now statically generate those mutexes, the content of those buffer objects, consisting of the pointer to the mutex and the empty buffer space, are turned into initializer lists too. To overcome this issue for those sparsely populated data structures containing mostly repeating values, we introduce run-length encoding of their initial values. Thereby, we combine the benefits of both data and BSS segments by issuing reads for the changing values and encoding the repeating parts as the amount of the equal values and their value. This results in a massive reduction of read instructions and less flash memory usage. Applying this run-length encoding as well, we see that the overall time needed to reach the system setup point lowers down to about 20,000 cycles, which is about the half of the original needed 40,000 cycles. We see the impact of the run-length encoding as the purple section shrinks and is replaced by a much smaller red section of the bar. For the memory usage, denoted in the lower diagram, we see that the numbers stay mostly the same or lower a little. With the run-length encoding in place, we have the full picture of ARA ready to be applied on our applications. Those applications could be fed into as LVM intermediate code from the left into the analysis. The static instance analysis examines the interprocedural control flow graph to find all instances and their parameters. The generator then produces new operating system objects and replaces system calls and their call sites with specialized implementations. During the link time optimization, we propagate the newly available static knowledge about the operating system objects and compress their data segments to produce the application and its system image. For evaluation purpose, we applied micro benchmarks as well as two real-world applications. The micro benchmarks consist of mass creation of operating system objects without interference from other applications' code. We executed them for queues, tasks, and other operating system objects to demonstrate the maximal benefit of our specialization. Our first real-world application is the GPS logger, which is a handheld device. It consists of 5 tasks, 2 queues, and 1 log and 3 interrupt service routines, and it receives GPS positional data, displays it on the screen, uses buttons to navigate through the menu structure, and stores the position onto an SD card. The second application is the LibrePilot, which is a quadrocopter flight controller. 17 call sites for task creation and 24 for queues build up the control for the motors, holding its position on flight and communicate with the ground station for control signals and telemetric data. With AWA, we are able to reduce the boot time towards the system setup point by up to 43% for the real-world applications like the GPS logger. For micro benchmarks, even higher improvements are possible. For all the systems, the optimization lowers the flash usage or comes at a moderate increase. To conclude my talk, I presented you our work on AWA, static initialization of dynamically created system objects. AWA is a whole system analyzer and optimizer, which reads the application source code, performs the static instance analysis to extract the instance list, generate operating system objects for those instances, and specialize the system calls for the application's needs. AWA is able to reduce the boot time of embedded real-time systems up to 43% for real-world applications and can be integrated into the compiler toolchain as it works fully automatic. The source code and benchmarks available on our website. There you also find the artifacts we supplied for the ARTAS artifact evaluation, which we successfully passed. Thank you very much for your attention, and I hope you enjoyed this presentation.